12th night, 8th day, cut and kept. Let us pray. Lord, that we might have eyes to see, ears to hear, the spirit to understand, that our soul might be transformed this day by your holy word. Make it so. Cut us to the quick, spirit from soul. We pray it so. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
12th night, 8th day, cut and kept. It is interesting that a phenomena in our country is we spend a whole lot of time preparing for and celebrating and getting ready for Christmas. And then quite often, as is the case, by 5 or 6 o'clock on Christmas Day, the tree is down, the decorations are all put away for yet another year. I had a neighbor who before Thanksgiving would put up their tree and decorate their house. But come Christmas Day, about late in the afternoon, they were done. Christmas was over. They packed it up and waited for another year. That is how our culture basically celebrates this. Now we have what? After Christmas sales. Christmas, according to our culture, is over and done with. However, in the Christian faith, Christmas is not a one-day event. It is a feast of 12 days. We're familiar with the 12 days of Christmas, the song, and we've heard all the different variations on it. But it represents the reality that Christmas is a season of 12 days. In biblical world, seasons and days and numbers have special meaning. They elicit a feeling, an image. They are more symbolic than they are actual counting. 12 days of Christmas means a full Christmas. How many tribes of Israel? 12. Enough. How many disciples? 12. Enough. How many days of Christmas? 12. Enough. When you have 12 of something, that's complete. That is why we have 12 days of Christmas. The day after Christmas, in other cultures, is celebrated a little more than it is even here. We know it's the Feast of Saint Stephen, or as my wife knows it, and they call it in her native Jamaica, it's Boxing Day. I never understood what boxing had to do with Christmas or what that meant. And after she explained it to me, I still have no idea what it means. But it has something to do with what good King Applesauce did there in that song on the Feast of St. Stephen. He goes out to and sees a poor beggar, and on that day you box up things and go and take care of the less fortunate. That's what happens on the second day of Christmas. 12 complete days. This, the Sunday that happens to fall after the Christmas day of Nativity, happens to be called a different kind of day, the eighth day. And we're going to look at that in just a moment. We want to pay particularly close attention to the scripture this morning because we don't want to get like the culture in dismissing Christmas as a one-day event. Jesus is born, let's get on with our lives. We know that Jesus is born in a wooden manger. and is born to go to a wooden cross. What is important for us who follow him and bear his name and have it written upon our souls, it's that area in between the wooden manger and the wooden cross. His life, his teaching, his example, his demonstration of what it is to be somebody who's a child of God, somebody who lives faith to the utmost, somebody who is blessed and is a blessing. It's that in between the manger and the cross that we want to pay close attention to, because it not only feeds and nurtures us, it can change us, transform us. The Holy Word of God is given to us that we might have it to lead us, to guide us in this transformation. So this before us is an opportunity to what the ancients called walking in the dust of your teaching. Galilee, Nazareth, Israel, very dusty place, very dry place. And when you would attach yourself to a rabbi, to a sage, to a teacher, you would walk behind them from little town to little town as he taught. And you would literally suck in their dust. You would wear their dust, for they would walk before you and you would be behind them. Walking in the dust of Rabbi Jesus is what every disciple is called to do, empowered by the Holy Spirit to do, entrusted to do. And this is what we want to do. We begin today. We begin today now that he's out of the manger. And we're going to walk with him as gospel gives us his life all the way to the cross. We begin today when he's yet still just a little child. And we heard read to us, and we're going to look at that and flesh it out a little more and come to understand what is this eighth day business all about. Remember, numbers are more about a quality than a quantity. We use numbers as quantity. How many people are here? 75. How many disciples were there? 12. We think that you get to 12 by counting 1, 2, 3, 4. And in the world of the Bible, that's how numbers are not used. Numbers are for quality. When you have 12, now what about 8, an eighth day? Well, we know that God created in 6 days and on the seventh rested. We have 7 days in a week. Our reality is 7 days. The eighth day is a new reality, a different reality, a resurrection reality that is foreshadowed way back in the book of beginnings, in the book of Genesis. And there is a law given by God, a commandment, in the 17th chapter of Genesis, in verses 9 through 12. And we will come to see that it is a reflection of a reality that is all embracing. Look at your scripture as it's printed in. We're going to flesh this out. Luke 2, 21 through 40. If you follow along, this is loaded. This is packed. And I think we missed most of it because there's just so much there. It says, and when 8 days had passed, there we have it. Eighth day, when 8 days had passed before his circumcision. Now, this 8 days is, of course, from this scripture. It says, God said in Genesis, God said to Abraham, now as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your descendants. That's everybody after you. Remember the promise to Abraham, you could be the father of many nations, and he was, and all your descendants after you throughout their generations. This is my covenant, which you shall keep between me and you and your descendants after you. So from Abraham, those who are the descendants of Abraham, keeping the covenant with God, will do this thing. In our scripture lesson, it's talking about Jesus. So from Abraham, the father of the faith, to Jesus, every male among you shall be circumcised. And you shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be the sign of the covenant between me and you. And every male among you who is 8 days old shall be circumcised throughout your generations. Here we have in the gospel part of the Christmas story, and when 8 days had passed before his circumcision, his name was then called Yeshua, or English, Jesus. And this is the name that was given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. So here we have, and what it's telling us is that Jesus, as a part of the tradition and the covenant, we are being told, lest we forget, that this is a particular God dealing with a particular people in a particular history. And as God deals with you in a particular way, in your particular life, in your particular circumstances, you don't have a generic God. You don't have a God who is out there for you to choose what he's going to look like, do, and be. You have a particular God who is Lord of all of history, who is sovereign, who has made a particular and definite covenant to send a Messiah through a people that he called his own. We get in this scripture, there is no way that you can separate, divorce, there's no way that you can take Jesus out of Israel. There's no way you can remove the fact that he is Jewish. In fact, what we're going to see throughout this particular scripture is that Jesus and Joseph, his father, and Mary, his mother, qualify as super Jews. You know some super Christians? These are super Jews. These are ones who have Judaism just beaming right out of them. Everything that is Jewish to do, they do meticulously. They do, if it says do it once, they'll do it twice. If it says do a little, they'll do it a lot. They were inside and out and all the way around. Everything that God was about, they were about in their faith as practicing Torah observant Jews. So before he's circumcised, he's given the name. This is done even to this day among those who are Jewish. On the 8th day, you are named, circumcised if you are a male. And it says in verse 22, and when the days for their purification, according to the law of Moses. Now, what is that about? The Jewish faith during the time of Jesus our Lord was all about the temple, and it was about sacrifices. You went to the temple and made sacrifices depending upon where you were in your life. We all have passages in our life. We have birthdays and we do certain things. It's common for us to have a cake, right? Sing happy birthday. We do certain things. In the faith of the Jews that Jesus is born into, they do too. And there are certain things that are done if they are practicing observant people. And they do. One is that when a woman has a child, whether male or female, she has to go through a period of ritual, okay, away from everybody else. there she becomes unclean, ritualistically unclean. That is, she can't go to the temple. She can't worship until a period. It has nothing to do with sin. It has to do with purification. And so when the time for Mary to be purified according to the law was completed, it says they brought him, that's Jesus, up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what was said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. This tells us more than we probably have ever gotten before. One, Mary and Joseph, super Jews. They're observing the Torah, the law, to the letter, to the T. They are going and doing everything prescribed for them to do. And since Jesus is the firstborn, this is the law of the firstborn. Every animal, every person, everything that is the firstborn belongs to God. When God redeemed Israel from Egypt by slaughtering the firstborn of the Egyptians and sparing the firstborn of Israel, he purchased, he redeemed them for himself. And so he says, every firstborn, whether it is your sheep or your cow or your donkey or your child, belongs to me, Yahweh, the Lord God. It's mine, it's not yours. And we see this in Leviticus. This is the law given thousands of years before Mary and Joseph are going to even be on the scene. We read, when the days of her purification are completed for a son or for a daughter, she shall bring to the priest at the doorway of the tent of meeting a one-year-old lamb for a burnt offering and a young pigeon or a turtle dove for a sin offering. Then he shall offer it before the Lord and make atonement for her, and she shall be cleansed from the flow of her blood. This is the law for her who bears a child, whether male or female. Then it goes on to say, but if she cannot afford a lamb, then she shall take two turtle doves or two young pigeons, the one for a burnt offering, the other for a sin offering, and the priest shall make atonement for her, and she will be clean. You might say, so what? One of the things it wants us to know is the social, political, economic status of the parents of our Lord. They couldn't afford a lamb. That means they were poor folk. They were so poor that they had to go with the provision. What does it say in your scripture? It says, a pair of turtle doves and two young pigeons. That's put in there so you know that they are very poor people. They are poor people, and they are going to the temple, and they give the poor persons sacrifice. Two turtle doves and two young pigeons. God made provisions. He wants a lamb from those who can afford it. Those who can't afford it, do the two birds. This is telling us, not only are they super Jews, but they're very poor. They're very poor super Jews, to which Jesus is born. It goes on, look at verse 25. And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout. And this man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. I want you to keep those verses in mind, because there's a whole lot of Christians who have to actually take a Sharpie and cross those out of their Bibles, because it makes no sense. How could he be righteous and devout? And how could he have the Holy Spirit? Because in their theology, they don't think there's any Holy Spirit until the day of Pentecost. And they don't think anybody can be righteous without accepting Jesus Christ. And yet here you have one, and earlier you have who? Elizabeth and Zechariah, who are what? Righteous before God. Righteous before God. And here this guy who's righteous, looking for consolation, has the Holy Spirit, and he is an old priest. And it says, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit, into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to carry out for him the custom of the law, again, super Jews, then he took him into his arms and he blessed God and said. Now you see what happens here is Joseph, because Jesus is the firstborn, Joseph takes the child in and it says there will be a redeemer priest. And you go to that priest who is Simeon. And you give him the child, and he says, this is a firstborn child. According to the law of Moses, we present him to you. And the offering to redeem him. Because you had to redeem him, purchase him back, because he belonged to God. And then the redeeming priest would say, and what is your will? To give this child to me. And he would then be raised there by the priesthood, or to, according to the law of Moses, redeem him back. And of course, Joseph paid the 5 shekels to redeem him back. And then what it says would happen is the redeemer priest would then bless the child. And this blessing we have here, the Song of Simeon. You see it beginning in verse 29. It says, now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, to the nations, and the glory of your people. Israel. And his father, Joseph, mother, Mary, were amazed at the things which were being said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and for a sign to be opposed. And a sword will pierce even your own soul to the end that the thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. How would you like to take your kid, getting christened or baptized or dedicated, and then have the minister or priest say, Mama, this kid is going to break your heart. This kid is going to make you suffer like you have never even imagined. You are going to really, really have a bad time. Congratulations. That's basically what Simeon was just doing. He was foreshadowing that the manger that we just celebrated, that wooden manger that held Christ the Lord, becomes a wooden cross. And the cross is never very far away at any point of the day. The cross is always there. He was born to die and to do in death. That wooden manger, that little Christ child whom we celebrate, grows and grow he must. For not only does he have something to show us and to teach us and to give to us, but he's a sacrifice to die for us. He goes on to say in the 36th verse that there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel. Now, if you look at Deuteronomy 19:15, somebody grab a Bible out of the pew and open up to the 19th chapter of Deuteronomy. Go ahead. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, fifth book. Open up to Deuteronomy 19. Everything in the Bible is there for a reason. The economy is such that God doesn't waste, as Jesus said, not a jot or a tittle, not an iota. Everything is there on purpose. So now we have this prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Peniel. Who's got Deuteronomy 19, chapter 15th verse? James, would you stand up and read that loudly? 15th verse.
And a single witness shall not prevail against a man for any crime or any wrong in connection with any offense that he has committed. Only on the evidence of two witnesses or of three witnesses shall a charge be sustained. If a malicious witness rise against any man to accuse him of wrongdoing, then both parties to the dispute shall appear before the Lord.
Okay. There, God has given a law that it takes two witnesses. Two witnesses, you don't believe anything unless there are two witnesses. Jesus lives this from here till the end. Every time he gives a teaching, he gives us two parables. Every time he gives a teaching, he performs two miracles. Here you have Simeon saying who this child is, recognizing, but that's just one witness. Ah, but here's a second, and her name is Anna of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years and had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. That is, she was married 7 years, he dies, and now she's at the age of 84. And for all these years, she stays there in the region of the temple, serving and waiting for Messiah. She never left the temple, serving night and day with fasting and prayers. At that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. You see, right there, thrown in the infancy narratives, we have Simeon, but then we got this old lady. And why is it there? It's there because the law of God says you have to have two. And what better two than these two old people who have dedicated their entire lives to God's stuff, to the temple, to looking and waiting on the promise that they would not succumb to death before Messiah had been given. Then it goes on in verse 29, and look what it says. In case we didn't get it, in case we've already forgotten that this is the King of the Jews, this is the Savior of Israel, the Messiah of God's chosen people. These are super Jews. He says, when they had performed everything, not just a little bit, when they did enough, no. When they had performed everything that the Torah, the instruction, the law of God had told them to do, they returned to the Galilee, to their own city of Nazareth. And the child continued to grow and become strong, increasing in wisdom. And the grace of God was upon him. Increasing in wisdom. Every first century Jew or Gentile Christian who read that knew that that was a Hebrewism. That is, we have certain sayings that we know what they mean, even if we don't know what they mean. If I say, boy, it's raining cats and dogs, you know what that means, right? Doesn't mean it's raining cats and dogs, it means it's raining hard. You know what that means, even not knowing where that comes from. It's an Americanism. There's also Hebrewisms. And one of the Hebrewisms that we know quite well is anytime it says that when the child grew, becomes strong, increasing in wisdom, it means one thing. He studied the Torah. Because only wisdom is found in the Torah. And it mentions throughout, from Genesis through Malachi, when someone increases in wisdom,